right.
Yeah.
Ooh. All right. How's everybody this morning? Everybody's here? Rick's good. You're good. Willow's ready. You're standing. She's good. All right. It's a good day, isn't it? Hallelujah. It's a good day. Yeah, she's already ready. I'll tell you what, let's all stand. Let's just open up in prayer this morning if we could. Father, we thank you so much for meeting us here this morning, Father.
Thank you, Lord.
We thank you for your, we just thank you that your presence is in our midst this morning. Where it says where two or more are gathered, there you are in our midst. And we thank you for that. We know you're everywhere, all the time. But I thank you that you're especially here this morning. that you're with your children, you're with your loved ones, the ones that you have called by name. And we thank you, God. We thank you for that. We thank you that we can come together as fellow believers and just worship and to hear words that will speak to us, words that will encourage us. And Lord, that we can bring our petitions before you boldly, before the throne this morning. We give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. And all the believers said, amen. Just want the word of God to speak to us this morning. I'm finding myself at loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would speak. Sing it out. The word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. The word of God speak. Yeah. Myself in the mystery, beyond the music, beyond the noise, and all that I need is to be with you in the quiet, hear your voice, the word of God.
Well, welcome. I'm glad that you braved the crazy weather.
I know that I went to pick up Willow this morning. It was early this morning. And her parking lot literally was a sheet of ice. It was crazy because it was on the southern exposure and it was just like you could see the ice. I come pulling in there and I started going sideways. And I'm going, oh, don't let me hit any cars. Kathy and I were driving yesterday to Target. Actually, not Target, to TJ Maxx. And the car in front of us started doing this. Boom. Into the gutter there. And if we had been beside her, that car, we'd have been taken out. So I am so glad that you made it here and you're safe. This week, this past week, did you get to see God work anywhere? We call it like praise and prayer time. Did you get to see God work? Because God is always doing something. Did you get to see Him show up? Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you that we get to experience you. We pray that you'll speak to us through your word and through fellowship and through the songs. We want to walk out of here, God, just full of you. We invite you to be here. Also pray for those who are struggling maybe financially, emotionally, physically. Rita and Linda, and God, I pray you put your healing hand upon them. Give the doctors wisdom and the family members as they have to make decisions. God, we love you so much. We believe in you. We trust you. We thank you so much for your son, Jesus. Thank you that we get to come here and worship. Guide us this morning.
All right. Ladies, ready?
I want a big, strong
song. You guys ready? Ready? All right. Everybody ready? As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Sing it out, because your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name. Sing it louder. There's nothing has the power to say but your name. Sing, ladies. Strength.
Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify your name.
Sing it out, here we go. Because your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder. Power to save, 'cause your name. Just the voices. Your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name. Let the nation sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to say. Sing it out. 'Cause your name is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Thank you. There's no other name under heaven or earth by which men may be saved. Amen. Woo! That's a good name there. Plus, he speaks a better word. Amen. Such a good song. Your blood is healing everyone. Your blood is making all things new. Your blood speaks a better word. Sing it out, your blood. Your blood. Measure my word.
Measure of my word. Your blood,
more than I
deserve. Your blood
speaks the better word.
Speaks the better word.
It's bringing out.
It's healing out with life.
Shouting down. Your blood, here we go.
Your blood,
a robe.
Robe of righteousness, your blood.
It's my hope.
My hope and my defense, your blood.
Forever.
Forever covers me. Yes.
Sing it out with blood. About the blood just for a second. Can we go back to the screen right before this one, McKenna? That is singing. It's blood. The blood of Jesus is singing out with life. It's shouting down the lies. The blood of Christ cleanses us. It cleanses our ears. It cleanses our eyes. How many of you know that there are lies that the devil wants you to hear? The blood of Jesus is more powerful than that. It echoes through the night. The precious blood of Christ. It speaks a better word. It speaks a better word than Fox News. It speaks a better word than CNN. It speaks a better word than any place else except for the Word of God. Let's just do that. Just kind of sing that out. It's singing out with life. It's shouting down the lies. It echoes through the night. The precious blood of Christ. It speaks a better word. It speaks a better word. And it's calling out my name. Come on. It's calling out my name. It does. It's breaking every chain. It makes all things right. Come on. It's making all things right.
The precious blood of Christ speaks a better word. Speaks a better word.
If you're like me or not, but I really needed these songs this morning. And so let's give them a round of applause for leading us in worship, drawing us closer to God. Ron, you did excellent. Let's give him a round of applause as well. This is 2 weeks in a row, Ron. I love it. And thank you so much for giving your all. I love it because Sunday mornings, Ralph always texts me or I always text him back and forth just saying, hey, it's going to be a good God day. And so thank you so much for leading us. We did it at the same time this morning. It's crazy. It was crazy. And I'm over here, and I'm, you know me, I get a little bit passionate. I love to sing. I especially love to worship. And so I had Kathy's hand, and I was singing, and I was holding her hand, and I was squeezing it really, really hard. And she looks, honey, you're hurting my hand. Okay, so I had to let go. But I'm so glad you're with us this morning. This morning might be just a little bit more what I would call relaxed because, hey, we're family here and family showed up here this morning. And it's nice to have people I haven't seen in a long time. Aaron, his lovely wife, his better half right there. So thank you for being here this morning. And Matthew and Krista and the family right there. Let's just give them a round of applause because I know it's not easy sometimes to make it, but you're here. And I'm going to tell you something. That last song fits into the very last point that I have in the sermon. Because we're going to be talking about the lame man that was by the pool. And Jesus comes and he says, do you want to be healed? Do you want that chain to be broken? And we're going to be looking at that story in detail. But before we do that, just a quick review of last week. Chapter 4. We had so much fun looking at the story of the woman at the well. Do you remember that? And we learned that the woman, she didn't even have a name, except for the name called the Samaritan. And she's at the well, she's an outcast, she's alone, she's a sinner, and Jesus shows up. And when Jesus shows up, something happens. And we got to listen to that story or read that story because Jesus shows up. And this is what we learned last week. It's this. Jesus meets us in unexpected places. He wasn't supposed to even go through Samaria. I had that map right last week and he went all the way. They could have went all the way around because the Samaritans, they're outcasts. But Jesus, he meets her at noontime at the well. Jesus is going to meet us in unexpected places. And then we closed out with this. I'm not who I used to be. I'm redeemed, full of grace. And I shared the story of this mountain right here called Sock Mountain. And I'm not the one who took the picture, but I have been about right in here looking up. And I shared last week how there was the parking lot, and you had to go up here and go through all these switchbacks to get up to on top of that ridge, and down here is where the lake is at, and right up here is where the picture was taken. And I shared with you about the young man who actually broke the rules, and he almost killed us, because the rule is this: you don't cut a switchback. You ever been hiking before? Matthew, you've been up there? Do not cut the switchback! And there was a group that was ahead of us, and they cut the switchback. And the rocks came down, almost killing us. And that young man was broken. Remember? I shared that last week. And I hiked up to him, and he was about right in here, approximately, and he was crying. Now, what do you think I did? Did I kick him and said, "You idiot, you almost killed us"? Kent came up to me afterwards, and Kent says, "You know, what would you have done if you would have had this arrogant attitude and stood up instead of being repentant, right?" He said, "I'm sorry," and he was broken and all this kind of stuff. But if he would have stood up and said, "I don't really care." And I said, "Kent, I don't know what I've done. What would you have done?" And Kent said, "I probably would have went off on him. But he was broken. And I showed him grace. I said, it's going to be okay." And he said, "He's sorry." That's the story of the woman at the well. It's full of grace. But today we're going to look at this right here. Chapter 5. We're going to have a lot of fun this morning looking at this story called the lame man. He was paralyzed, and he couldn't get up and get into the water to be healed. I don't know if you're familiar with the show called The Chosen. Some of you have already probably watched it, but The Chosen, I heard it's really, really good. It's on our bucket list to watch. But I took a clip from it, and it's going to show us in about 3 minutes the story, and then we'll read the text, and then we're going to actually see what it has to say for us with two questions moving forward. But this right here, we're going to talk about it at the very end. Now, I do have a question. I'm walking over to this side. Do you know why? Because I want to know, Isaac, if you know what this is. Cassette tape! Woohoo! You did it. I was a little worried you wouldn't know what it is. So you had 8 tracks, right? And then you had cassette. And then you have, what's after that? CDs. And then after that? Bluetooth, DVD, right? And then after that you have MP3s, then you have MP4s, and it just kind of evolves. Well, I'm going to talk about a story behind this cassette tape at the end. So don't fall asleep, don't leave, because you want to make sure you are here for the story. But let's watch the video, and then I'll come back up and we'll read the text. Here's the video.
Shalom. Me? Yes. Shalom. I have a question for you.
For me. I don't have many answers, but I'm listening.
Do you want to be healed?
Who are you?
We'll get to that later. But my question remains.
Will you take me to the water? Look, I'm having a really bad day.
You've been having a bad day for a long time. So?
38 years of bad days. Sir, I have no one to help me into the water when it's stirred up. And when I do get close, the others step down in front of me. So,
look at me. Look at me. That's not what I asked. I'm not asking you about who's helping you, or who's not helping, or who's getting in your way. I'm asking about you.
I've tried.
For a long time, I know. And you don't want false hope again, I understand. But this pool, it has nothing for you. It means nothing. And you know it. But you're still here. Why?
I don't know.
You don't need this pool.
He said, don't forget your bed.
Why does this matter?
Because you're not coming back here. That life is over. Everything changes.
Well, what'd you think? I love it. There are so many great moments in this story. But let's look at it by reading this, the passage of Scripture, okay? So in John chapter 5, it says this. Inside the city near the sheep gate was the pool of Bethesda with the five covered areas. Crowds of sick people, blind, lame, or paralyzed, lay on their different mats or porches. One of the men laying there had been sick for 38 years. When he said he was having a bad day, I kind of started chuckling because I knew it was 38 years. I turned to John back then. I said, for 38 years, he'd been having a bad day, okay? So he was paralyzed. He's laying there by the pool, like what we saw in the video. When Jesus saw him and knew he had been ill for a long time, he asked him, would you like to get well? Would you like to be healed? I was thinking about this. All the other people were laying there. Why did Jesus pick this person to choose him? Do you ever think about that? All they said, there was other people laying around there. Why did he choose him? I don't know if we'll know the answer, but this might kind of help a little bit, is because he knew that he had been there for 38 years. There's a lot of history that happens in 38 years, and perhaps other people were watching to see what was going to happen. And Jesus knows that. That's part of the miracle story. He knows you've been there a long time, 38 years. I choose you out of everybody here because you got the most baggage, so to speak. Everybody else gets to go, and I don't get healed. I just think that's interesting that Jesus chose him. And then he goes on, and the guy says, I can't, sir, the sick man said, for I have no one to put me into the pool when the water bubbles up. Someone else always gets there ahead of me. Jesus told him, stand up. Love this part. Stand up, pick up your mat, and walk. There's power in the name of Jesus. We just got through singing that. There's power. This morning, don't miss that. Please. There's power in the name of Jesus. God brought you here for a reason. You're here because you need to hear the message that there's power in the name of Jesus. He says, stand up, pick up your mat, and walk. Instantly, the man was healed. He rolled up his sleeping mat and began walking. But this miracle happened on the Sabbath. That's a completely different story. Because if you notice in the video, you had the Pharisees kind of watching. They're trying to see what Jesus was going to do. And he heals him on the Sabbath. I love Jesus. I think he did it on purpose, by the way. It's like, I'm going to get you guys, right? He just has that, I'm going to watch this. But that's a different story, different day, different lesson. So, but the question is this, if you follow along, take a note, you can. Why would Jesus ask this question? It's one of those questions, you're like, duh, do you want to be healed? It's a simple yes and no response. You don't get to say maybe, kind of, sort of, perhaps. Jesus said, do you want to be healed? Why did Jesus ask this question? Because you and I, for 38 years, you would think the guy go, yes, heal me, 38 years. Come on, what do I need to do to get healed? But he doesn't. He doesn't say yes. I think Jesus was testing him. I think with the question, Jesus is trying to get a little bit deeper. It's not your standard question. Do you want to be healed? It's taking it down a couple levels. It's this, to test him to see if he really wants to change. Because we know this, change is very, very difficult. Can I get an amen? Come on now, that was weak. Can I get an amen? Change is very, very difficult. For 38 years, this man had been doing the same thing, laying by this pool, waiting to get there. If he was to be healed, his world is going to be turned upside down. He'd have to get a job. Come on, let that sink in, okay? He'd have to be doing something different. Change is very difficult. And the older we get, the harder it is to change. Right, Mac? Amen. I was hoping he would say that. But it's true. Now, I put this word up here, hair. Because I have a funny story to share with you. I've been wearing my hair this way for 30-something years. Most of you know all this junk that I had to go through with this right here. We met with a plastic surgeon. Got a smile with me on this. Before surgery. And he literally was kind of like drawing things on my head. And he says, now, I'm going to have to cut here. And I'm going to have to do things and pull it over here. And at the end, we don't know what your hair is going to look like. Remember that? And he said, he goes, And you might have to have your hair kind of do a different little thing to it. I'm thinking, no. I like my hair. Exactly the way it is. I've been doing it for 30 years. I don't want to change. Seriously. Some of you out there, I dare you to change your hair. No way, I've been doing it. You know what I'm saying? As a matter of fact, Ron and I were kind of talking this morning. He didn't know I was actually going to share this. He said, well, Bill, you know, you're looking really good. Your hair is. Maybe you should just shave it because you're getting a little light on top. Ron said that to me this morning. I said, Ron, my enemies don't say that to me. I didn't really say that part. But the point is, change is difficult, isn't it? So Jesus was saying, do you really want to be healed? Do you really want to change? Wow, it's almost the question behind the question. You might want to take a picture of this. We cannot become what we want by remaining what we are. So true. Jesus, love this profound question. Do you want to be healed? Do you want to remain where you're at, or do you want to change? And this is so true. It's so true. Some of us are saying, well, I want to change, but yeah. Really, do you? I think that's what Jesus was saying. Do you want to be healed? It's up to you. Love it. This one right here. This got a smile with me because this is happening in our culture so much, and maybe even in our own lives, to expose him for the attitude of being a victim. What does he say? Instead of saying yes, he makes excuses. Can't, sir. The sick man said, for I have no one to put me into the pool when the water bubbles up. Someone else always gets there ahead of me. Do you see this? He's saying, I'm the victim here. I can almost, in the video wasn't quite this way, but I'd be like more, if I was directing, I'd be a little bit more sarcasm in it. A little bit more, oh, I can't get into the water. I can't get there. Nobody can. You see the attitude? I think Jesus was exposing by this question, do you want to be healed? I'm going to reveal to you that you play the victim role. Stop it. Do you want to change? Do you want to be healed? It's going to take something. Stop playing the victim role. Follow along with me as I read this and kind of see maybe yourself or maybe somebody that you know or maybe the world we're living in. If you're a victim, if you have victim mentality, you will see your entire life through a perspective that things constantly happen to you. Victimization is thus a combination of seeing most things in life as negative, beyond your control, and as something you should be given sympathy for experiencing as you deserve better. I kind of see that in our culture a little bit. At its heart, a victim mentality is actually a way to avoid taking responsibility for yourself or your life. By believing you have no power, then you don't have to take action. That's what he was doing. See, Jesus knew that in that very question. Are you going to play the victim role? Or are you going to take responsibility for your own sin? Where you're at in life? Do you want to be healed? Paul says it this way. I love this scripture. It is so good. You were taught with regard to your former way of life or thinking to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires. This idea of being a victim. To be made new in the attitude of your minds and to put on the new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. As Christians, we're called to put off that attitude of being a victim. Does anybody remember a guy that used to live in our parking lot? I had his name up there on the last slide. His name was Mitch. Does anybody remember? Come on, raise your hand if you remember. I know I remember Mitch. I liked his dog better than him. I'm just being honest. His dog, Caddy, was amazing. But I always knew when Mitch was having a bad day because Caddy would not go close to Mitch. Mitch used to be right out here. Dog Caddy would come into the church building. Loved that dog. It was awesome. Come into the church building, she'd go back out, but she would avoid Mitch. Mitch was homeless. But Mitch played the victim role big time. Now, this is not true for all homeless people. But for Mitch, he didn't really want to stop living in his van. He literally had the mayor of Broomfield's phone number on his cell phone. I talked to the mayor of Broomfield. She offered him a place to stay. Did he go? No. Because he didn't want to change. He didn't want to be healed. He wanted to play the victim role. I just share that with you. Because he didn't want to change. I think if Jesus would have said, hey, Mitch, do you want to be healed? No response. I can't be healed because. I love Marcus because Marcus hates that attitude of the victim. It's true. Second question. I think it's a powerful fact. What is the significance of Jesus telling the lame man to what? Take up your mat and walk. He says, do you want to be healed? And we saw it. Now, pick up your mat and walk. It comes down to three things I think that Jesus was doing by saying this. What's the power of him saying this? It is so good. He says, because do you trust me? Hey, he's looking at the guy in the video. Pick up your mat. The mat, he had a choice to say yes or no. Do you trust me? Listen to this. It is so true. Trust always requires taking action. You can't just say, I'm going to trust and not do something. I have Kathy's name right here because there's a funny story. We were actually talking about this. And I don't know how we got on the subject. But about trusting herself. About taking action. She was on our roof at our house in Mount Lake Terrace. She wanted me to remind you that it was a ranch style house. Okay. So she's on the roof and she's cleaning our skylights. She had a bottle of Windex and some, you know, paper towels. And then she also had the hose up there. And it was going and she was cleaning, I don't know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 skylights we had. And they were covered. And she was up there working away. Well, the water kept coming down onto our deck. And that's where the ladder was at. So you had the water coming down onto the deck. And then right beside that was our trampoline. We had a big trampoline. Loved that thing. But she's on the roof. Something happened where the ladder, she couldn't use it. I don't know if it fell. I can't remember. Did it fall? It fell. So picture her on the roof, water running, and no ladder. And I wasn't around. And that was before cell phones. She's up there. In her mind, she trusted herself to be able to jump onto the trampoline from the roof. We all chuckle, right? She let go of the hose. It went down. She takes the spray bottle and she throws it onto the trampoline. But she's on the edge. And by the way, there's like a little gap there. It's not just dropping. It's a little gap. She had to jump. But in her mind, she's saying, I know I can do this. But then a little doubt comes in, right? What happens if I jump and I go flying off? Or I trip and I fall down and there's cement right there and Bill comes home and my brains are all over the place. And I mean, all that kind of stuff perhaps is going through her mind. But she, listen, she had to have action. She couldn't just say there and stand there and go, I can do this. What do you think she did? She jumped. Wait. Woohoo, that's pretty cool. But what she didn't realize was she had thrown the bottle onto the trampoline. And when she landed, it was safe. But the bottle flew up and hit her in the face. She still has a massive scar right here. No, I'm kidding. But the point is, listen to the point. She could stand up there all day long and go, I trust myself, I trust myself, I trust myself. It doesn't do any good until you jump. The blind man, not the blind man, the paralyzed man, he's there and he's going, okay, pick up my mat and walk. I got to have some trust there. I got to have some trust. Second one is this. Consider it all joy, my brothers. That's what James says. When you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. What's this saying? You will be tested. You're going to stand there, and Jesus is going to say, do you trust me? Do you? I loved what Ron said in his testimony up here. All that stuff going on, he prayed and he trusted. That's pretty cool. Second thing, take up your mat and walk. I think this is so good to show finality. He didn't leave his mat there. That's what Jesus is saying. Pick it up. Don't leave it there. Because you're not coming back. Woohoo! That's awesome. You're not coming back. Take everything with you. And when he says the mat, He's talking about your blankets. You're talking about maybe a water bottle, whatever it is. You're taking everything with you because you're not coming back. Listen, you're not staying here anymore. It's over. That life is over. See, Jesus could have simply said, stand up and walk. But he added, pick up your mat. Pick up all that junk, that life, and you can follow me. I think it's powerful. This last one. Answer the question. I just love this one. It demonstrates his compassion. Jesus chooses to heal him anyway. The man never says, yes, I want to be healed. You and I are so stubborn sometimes. Okay, not me, you. You're stubborn! I don't want to change. I don't want to pick up my stuff. I don't want to move forward. Jesus is still going to heal you. Jesus chooses to heal you. That's awesome. So here's some simple things that we can do, okay? The question is this. Do you want to be healed? Do you want to break every chain? By the way, Ralph didn't know what I was going to preach on. He didn't. He let the Spirit guide him. Break every chain. Perhaps this morning, I wish that each of us could just like write down, what do you want to be healed of? Maybe it's damaged area in your lives, brokenness, insecurity, fear, whatever it is. Addictions. You walk in here this morning. What do you want to be healed from? Relationships. Could be a spouse. Could be a sibling. Fill in the blank. See, Jesus is asking that question this morning. Maybe it's worries. What are you anxious about? What do you need to be healed of? I was thinking about this. It is so easy to answer this question for somebody else. I know that person needs to be healed of this. Smile with me. I know that that person has this problem. I know. How about this? What do you need to be healed of? Pick up your mat and walk. That's what it's about. Change is hard at first, correct? That's how Jesus started it out. Do you want to be healed? Messy in the middle and gorgeous at the end. That's the way change is. It's difficult. Messy in the middle. And when you get to the other side, with Jesus, it's going to look gorgeous. C.S. Lewis said this. You can't go back and change the beginning, but you can start where you are and change the ending. See, the guy that was laying by the pool, don't check out on me. Okay, we're almost there. He was laying at the pool, right? He couldn't go back to 38 years ago and go, let's change back there. Jesus is giving him a chance to change right now. By the way, that can preach. And then this next one by Francis Chan. Oh, it's so good. It's so good. God wants to change us so much that it intrigues others. See, when that guy stood up, picked up his mat, and I can just imagine dancing, going, wah! Everybody else is watching, and they got to see the power of Jesus demonstrated. That's what Jesus wants to do in you. When you say, yes, I want to be healed. Yes, I want to change. I'm not going to play the victim role anymore. I want to do something. Then Jesus gets to shine through you. That's amazing. I told you I was going to talk about this right here. I don't know when I shared this story, but it's such a good story about my friend Jason English in Bible college. Jason English
was an amazing guitarist. He wasn't acoustic, he was electric. And he came, and he was my roommate in Bible college. And he came, and he could play that thing. It was awesome to see him play it. But he didn't know any worship songs. He only knew the songs that were what he would call trashy music. Music that had bad lyrics, okay? All these things. He was actually in a band. Kind of like maybe Eric was in a band in the past. But he was in a band. And when he met Jesus, Jesus called him to change. Jason, I want to heal you. Jason, I want you to go to Bible college. Now, Jason could have said, nope, going to stay where I'm at. Going to do what I want to do. But in a sense, he had to pick up his mat. He had to leave all those friends. And he had to follow Jesus. He had to pick up his mat and walk. Jason had all kinds of cassettes of his music and music that he would call trashy music. Do you remember this story? And I'll never forget this. We're in our dorm room and Jason says, you know what? I need to leave that stuff behind. Let's go into the parking lot and let's find a big rock and let's smash all of my cassettes because it's over. I'm all in with Jesus. I'm all in. So what we did, it was awesome. We took his cassette. I don't know how many were there. And we took him outside. And I found a big old brick. And he found a big old rock. And we began to smash those things. And every single time, Jason had this big old smile on his face. Because he was picking up his mat, so to speak. And he was all in with Jesus. Jason is now in the military. He's a chaplain in the Air Force. God took him through Bible college and he pursued God. Great friends with Kathy and I. He's married now. That's Jason. Jason was broken and hurting and mixed up and lost. And Jesus said, do you want to be healed? He said, yes, I'm all in. And he went and took faith. Aaron's here. Aaron didn't know I was going to share this story. But Aaron's here as a recruiter for Bible college. Not per se to recruit us. But he has seen people who make... Aaron himself was over here and said, oh man, you're calling me to go into ministry? Ah! And you just go. I appreciate men like Aaron stepping up and going. Jason is there changing lives. He's preaching all the time. So our takeaway is this. Do you want to be healed? And if the answer is yes, pick up your mat and go all in. That's awesome. Get off the fence. Go all in. Let's pray. God, thank you so much for this great lesson that you gave us this morning. From this story that John shared with us. About a man that was lame for 38 years. And Jesus, you came along and you healed. You showed compassion. Continue to heal us. We invite you to step in. To transform us, to renew us, to help us have a better attitude about life. We love you. Thank you for the grace. In Jesus' name, amen. We're coming to a time in our service, I love to say this, where we get to come to the cross and experience Jesus through communion. So I invite the worship team to come. And as they're coming, I just ask that you start kind of preparing your mind for what Jesus Christ did for us on that cross. The song that we sang about the blood, it is so good. Because it's the blood of Jesus that sets us free. Do you want to be healed? Maybe this morning, during your time of meditation, maybe you can just kind of start thinking, take a mental list and go, you know, I've been holding on to this stuff. I need to let it go and go all in. Would you do that? As you meditate and think about what Jesus Christ did for you on that cross. Anytime during this song, you're more than welcome to go in the back. Love to have you do that. Pick up the cup. Right below it, there's another cup that has the bread in it. You can take the whole thing back here and we'll take it together. We'll have a time of just meditating and thinking about what Jesus Christ did for us on that cross. And if you have any tither offerings, you can do that as well. Or a prayer request. Go ahead and fill that out and put that in the contribution plate. Anytime during this song.
There's a table that you prepared for me in the presence.